Now today we are going to discuss the inductance of a toroidal core along with the coaxial cable. I think these three derivations is sufficient for you to find inductance of. We already found out inductance of solenoid. Then we'll move on to toroidal core. Then we'll move on to the coaxial cable. And also we'll try to take one or two examples, problems pertaining to finding inductance and flux density, everything. Okay. Now today, I'll just start with finding inductance of a toroidal core. I'll share you the derivation part of toroidal core. I think video is visible. This is the toroidal core on which a number of coils are wound, and the current flowing through that coil is I. R is the radius of the toroidal core. A is the area of cross section of the toroidal core. You can see something like a ring. Okay, on a magnetic material, you have wound a coil. And you are passing a current through this coil. When you pass a current through this coil, what happens? A magnetic field is set up in the magnetic material, and the magnetic flux starts flowing in the magnetic path. The path followed by the magnetic flux is nothing but what you call it as magnetic circuit. Unlike in electric circuit, the path followed by electric current is nothing but electric circuit. Same way, the path followed by magnetic flux is nothing but magnetic circuit. You can see. Whenever you pass a current through this coil, a magnetic field is set up. This magnetic field will going to choose the least resistance path. The least resistance path is supposed to be having a low reluctance. You heard of reluctance? Reluctance is the it is the what you call it as the opposition offered for the flow of the magnetic flux is nothing but reluctance, something like resistance. The resistance is the opposition offered by the conductor for the flow of current. Same way, what is reluctance? Reluctance is the opposition offered by the material or the magnetic material for the flow of magnetic flux is nothing but what I call it as reluctance. You already you come across reluctance in basic electrical. You know that S is equal to L divided by mu naught mu r into A. L is the length of the magnetic circuit. And mu naught mu r A is the area of cross section of the magnetic path. Okay. Now I have defined N is the number of coils wound on the magnetic material. R is the radius of the toroid starting from the center to the center of the coil is nothing but what you call it as R. I is the current flowing through the coil. Here I have not mentioned A. A is the area of cross section of the toroidal core. Area of cross section of this toroidal core. I'll directly take what you call it as the magnetic flux density. The magnetic flux density due to toroidal core, if you derive, you'll going to get the expression B is equal to mu into Ni divided by 2 pi R. Okay, this is the derivation which is directly taken from the already done analysis. Hope I think we have not taken the derivation for this. I can directly put the value of B as mu into N into I divided by 2 pi R. Mu is the permeability, N is the number of turns, I is the current which is flowing through the coil, R is the radius of the toroidal core. So directly you can write B is equal to mu N I divided by 2 pi R. You know the total flux is given by B is equal to N into phi. Phi can be written as B into A. So in turn, I have written B into A into N. So total flux linking always is given by N into phi. instead of phi, I am replacing it as by b into a. We already know what is b for this. Substitute b value from the above. You can get mu into n into I divided by 2 pi r into a into n. Okay, this is the total flux linking. We know the definition of self inductance. L is equal to total flux divided by the current flowing. So total flux is n into phi. Total flux linking the toroid is n into phi, and the current flowing through the toroid is I. So when I substitute that, I can write it as mu into n squared I a divided by 2 pi r into I. I will get cancels, giving you the expression for inductance. L is equal to mu into n squared into a divided by 2 pi r. This is the expression for inductance of a toroidal core. Yeah, any doubts in that? Any doubts? And we take up an example on finding the inductance of a toroidal core. Okay. All of you take pen and paper. How come less students today? Only 26 are there. Janavi?
Sir?
Why very less students? From morning less students were there?
No, sir. 36 were there.
And how come only 26 students have logged in till now? You please take the problem pertaining to finding inductance of toroidal core. Consider an air cored toroidal with 500 terms. Consider an air cored toroid with 500 terms. Cross section area of 6 cm². Cross section of 6 cm² and the mean radius of 15 cm. Mean radius of 15 cm. And carries 4 amps. Okay. Find reluctance, comma inductance L B, that is magnetic flux density and magnetic field intensity H. I'll repeat the question once again. Consider an air core toroid with 500 terms, cross section area of 6 cm² and mean radius of 15 cm and carries 4 amps. Find reluctance. Reluctance is always represented by S, comma inductance L, comma flux density B, and magnetic field intensity H. These are the different parameters you have to find. First, you list out the data. Okay, what all is given? I'll just list the data. He has given area of cross section. Area of cross section is how much?
6 cm².
6 cm². Can convert this into meter squared as 6 × 10⁻⁴ m². Okay. Length is given No, radius is given.
15 centimeter.
You can convert this into meters as 15 into 10 to the power of minus 2 meters. Okay. And what else is given? I is given. I is equal to 4 amps.
4 amps.
Number of tons is given?
N is 500.
N is equal to 500.
500.
Yes, what all he has asked to find? He has asked to find reluctance S. He has asked to find L, self inductance of toroid. He is asked to find B and he is asked to find H. Okay. Now, reluctance, always remember S is equal to L divided by mu naught mu r into A. Reluctance is the opposition offered by the medium for the flow of magnetic flux. Okay. Is given by this. Now, substitute all the values which you know. Since it's an air core solenoid, mu r will be equal to 1, L is 15 into 10 to the power of minus 2 divided by mu naught is 4 pi to 10 to the power of minus 7 into 1 into 6 into 10 to the power of minus 4. Get me S value. How much is S? S. L, we don't know what is, sorry, this is, he has not given L value, correct? You have to find L value. He has given R value.
Yes, sir.
What, how to get circumference length of a toroid? Whatever I have written is wrong. L you have to find. L is equal to, I can write it as, how to get circumference of the circle?
2
how to get r. Circumference? Huh?
2 pi r.
2 pi r, correct? Yes or no?
Sir.
So 2 pi sir. Into r. You have to substitute in order to get the length of the circumference length. That is the length of the magnetic path you have to get. So L is equal to 2 pi r, you have to substitute. Here it is, whatever I have written is you have to multiply that into 2 pi. Got my point? Now you multiply it by 2 pi and give me the answer. Did you get my point here? See, you have toroid, no, toroid will be like this. Okay. This is your toroid. How do you get the length? Circumference length of this toroid. The circumference length of the toroid is given by L is equal to 2 pi r. Okay, that's what I have mentioned there. So for that you have to 15 into 10 to the power of minus 22 into 2 pi you multiply, you will go to get the length L. How much is this value?
One point two five into ten to the power of nine.
Ten to the power of 9 ampere tons per Weber. Unit for reluctance. Ampere tons per Weber. You know, the formula for finding inductance of an toroid, L is equal to mu naught into N square. Correct? Just now you derived, what is the formula for finding toroid? Mu into mu naught into N squared into A divided by 2 pi r. Get me inductance of the toroid. You know all the values there. Substitute mu naught. N is 500. 10 to the power of minus 7 into 500 squared. Into area of cross section is 6 into 10 to the power of minus 4, okay, divided by 2 pi into r is 15 into 10 to the power of minus 2. How much is the inductance value? You tell me.
2 into 10 power minus 4.
2 into?
10 power minus 4.
0.2 millihenry, yeah? 0.2 millihenry.
Yes, sir.
Correct, huh?
Yes, sir.
B, how do you get the flux density of an toroid? Mu n I divided by 2 pi r.
Two point six six meters into ten per minus square.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
2.66 milliwebers per meter squared. H is equal to B divided by mu naught.
Two point one two into ten to the power of three.
Okay, ampere tons per meter. Got my point?
Yes.
This is how we can find out different parameters pertaining to toroid. Okay. All of you can go through the problem. What all he has given? He has given cross-sectional area of the toroid as 6 cm². Then he has given the radius of a toroid as 15 cm. Current flowing through the coil is 4 amps. Number of turns is 500. So by this data, you have to find the reluctance, inductance, flux density, and magnetic field intensity. That's what we have found. Okay. Any doubts in this? Did everyone got the answers? Ampere turns per meter is magnetic field intensity. Yeah. Now, we would like to continue with one more derivation, that is to find the inductance of an coaxial cable. To find inductance of coaxial cable, I'm going to show you the next derivation on the screen. All of you can see the coaxial cable. Okay. The coaxial cable has an inner radius of, it has two conductors, inner conductor and outer conductor. And the space between the two conductors is filled with the dielectric with a different permeability, mu r, with a different mu r. Means the inner conductor has a radius of A and the outer conductor inner radius is B. The outer conductor radius is B. The inner conductor radius is A. The outer conductor inner radius is B. We are not bothered about the outer conductor outer radius. We are just bothered about the outer conductor inner radius. Okay. So I have shown the coaxial, the length of the coaxial cable as D. Okay. We know that the magnetic field intensity of a coaxial cable is between radius of closed Gaussian surfaces between A to B is given by H is equal to I divided by 2 pi r. Is my voice is audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, we know the expression for magnetic field intensity of an coaxial cable. The magnetic field intensity of an coaxial cable is given by H is equal to I divided by 2 pi r, where the closed path varies from A to B. Okay. So that's what I have written. Where A, R is between A and B. Same way, I can find out what is the flux density. B is equal to mu into H. So when I substitute B is equal to mu into H, B is equal to mu into I divided by 2 pi r, you will go into that. Now, assume that the axis of the coaxial cable is along z axis. Okay. And the axis of the coaxial cable is along z axis. Okay. Now we can define what you call it as flux. The flux is given by surface integral of B dot ds. The flux density is always, you know, along A phi direction. When the current is flowing along the z direction, your flux density will be always in A phi direction. So surface area we will go to, you know, define in A phi direction as we will have two surface integrals. So r varying from A to B means your radius you can vary from A to B, and z varies from 0 to D. We know B is nothing but mu into I divided by 2 pi r. Surface integral, we have two. What is surface area in A phi direction? Surface area in A phi direction is dr into dz into A phi. We should have one more. B is also along A phi direction. So A phi will become one. Okay. So you integrate in the next step. Pi is equal to mu into I divided by 2 pi. Integration of dz is nothing but z between the limit 0 to d. Another one, integral of 1 by r into dr is ln log r between the limits a and b. When you substitute the limits, you are going to get phi is equal to mu I d divided by 2 pi into ln b by a. Okay. Now we know that the definition for what you call it as the inductance, total flux linking the a coil divided by current flowing. So total flux linking is n into phi divided by I. Here, you can write it as mu. The phi, we already got the expression for phi. Substitute the phi there. So that will be the expression for inductance. Where II will get cancels. You left with mu d into n divided by 2 pi into ln b by a is the expression for inductance of a coaxial cable. You can also neglect n because n is the number of turns. The number of turns for coaxial cable is equal to 1. So the expression for inductance is equal to L is equal to mu d divided by 2 pi into ln b by a. Where b is the radius of outer conductor, a is the radius of inner conductor. I'll just repeat the derivation once again. I have taken a coaxial cable of length d, okay, and what is the magnetic field intensity of a coaxial cable is given by H is equal to I divided by 2 pi r. When r is between A to B, we can also convert that into flux density. B is equal to mu into H. You get it as mu into I divided by 2 pi r. That the flux density will be in A phi direction. So if you write it in vector form, vector B is equal to mu into I divided by 2 pi r into A phi. So we can find flux by definition of flux density. So phi is equal to surface integral of B dot ds. So surface integral in A phi direction is given by dr into dz. So we'll have two surface integrals in which r varying from A to B and z varying from 0 to D. When you apply the integration and apply the limits, you'll going to get the expression for phi flux as mu into I d divided by 2 pi into ln b by a. We know that definition for inductance as L is equal to n phi by I. So n just substituted phi value there, II will get cancels. We'll go to get the expression for L is equal to mu d into n divided by 2 pi into ln into b by a, where n is equal to 1 for coaxial cable. So you can modify this inductance formula as L is equal to mu d divided by 2 pi into ln b by a is the expression for inductance of a coaxial cable. Any doubts there? You have any doubts pertaining to finding the inductance of a coaxial cable?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Is this extended part unit length L by D is the index for unit length. Always we measure the inductance per unit n divided by 2 pi into L n V by A, where n can be equal to 1. So mu divided by 2 pi into L n V by A is the expression for the inductance per unit length. I will take one my example on this, finding the inductance of a coaxial cable. Take down. All of you take pen and paper. Calculate the inductance of a calculate the inductance of a 10 meter length of coaxial cable filled with a material for which mu r is equal to 80. Relative permeability mu r is equal to 80, and radii of inner and outer conductors are radii of inner and outer conductors are 1 mm and 4 mm respectively. Direct, once you know the formula, direct substitution. All of you heard the problem? I'll repeat the problem once again. Calculate the inductance of 10 meter length of an coaxial cable filled with a material for which mu r is equal to 80 and radii outer conductors are 1 mm and 4 mm respectively. Okay. Then we have outer radius as B is equal to 4 mm. Then we have length D. D is given. D is equal to 10 meters long. Okay. And he has asked to find what is the inductance. L is equal to what? Just now we derived what is the expression for inductance of a coaxial cable. The inductance of a coaxial cable is equal to mu into D divided by 2 pi r.
2 pi, that's it, sir.
2 pi, no? Yes. Ln into B by A. Mu is nothing but mu naught into mu r. Mu naught into mu r into D divided by 2 pi into Ln B by A. Okay. We have all the values given. I have retained that mm because numerator, denominator, mm will get cancelled. So you need not to convert that. You can directly get L is equal to 4 pi into 10 to the power of minus 7 into 80. Okay. D is 10 centimeter.
10 meters
into 2 pi into Ln. B is 4. A is 1. And get me how much is inductance L value.
2.2 into 10 power minus 4.
Okay, 221 micro or
yes,
0.2 22 milli henry.
Yes, sir, you can write it that, sir.
Right now?
Yes.
0.22 milli henry. Okay. So this ends module 4. Okay. And I already listed what are the important questions you have to, you know, go through in module 4. Especially module, first chapter in module 4 is magnetic force. Second one is magnetic materials. In that we have discussed classification of magnetic materials. Then we moved on to boundary conditions, finding boundary conditions, correct? So boundary conditions, we have only one case. Second case, you can extend that if you take current density, surface current density is equal to zero, that will be the second case. Okay, so boundary conditions important. You study boundary conditions. Then you study the classification of magnetic materials. Then simple derivations pertaining to solenoid. Then you have toroidal core and the coaxial cable. And also we have done simple examples on all the three. Okay, so this ends this module 4. Okay, we'll move on to module 5. That is time varying fields. Okay. Yeah, you have any doubts pertaining to magnetic materials?
No, sir.
I think we have covered most part of module 4, except for some parameters in magnetic materials. We have picked and chose some topics in magnetic materials. We have not completed full, but you'll be the person to answer 100 marks in the exam, main exam. And probably your college will reopen from June 1st. That's what I heard. They had a meeting and they told that college may reopen from June 1st. And maybe for 1 month, you'll have internals, lab sessions, okay? And then some revision classes you'll have. So after June, you're going to have your main exams. Main theory exams you'll have in July. Practical exams maybe in August. Okay. Now, coming back to module 5, it's called time-varying fields. Again, we have two topics in module 5. One is called time-varying fields. Other one is called uniform plane waves. Okay. Now, I'll go to share you the topic pertaining to time-varying fields. Now, you must remember, what is a time-varying field? Suppose a static electric charges constitute electric field. Okay. A steady current flowing through the conductor produces in a static magnetic field. Do you get my point here? How do you get an electric field? The presence of a static charges in a region produces an electric field. You have some charges in that particular region, you find an electric field. Suppose if you have a current carrying conductor, the current carrying conductor is surrounded by magnetic field. If the current through the conductor is a steady current, the magnetic field is also static around the conductor. So, in the previous sections, we discussed separately what is the relations for static electric field, what is the relations for static magnetic fields. We arrived at Maxwell's equations, okay, for electrostatics as well as static magnetic fields. Suppose a AC current flows through what you call it as a conductor. Just imagine we thought of being passing a DC current through the conductor. The region around the conductor is a static magnetic field. Suppose if you pass a AC current through the conductor, what happens? The region around the conductor will be variable magnetic field. So magnetic field varies with respect to time is nothing but time varying magnetic field. A electric field vary with respect to time is called time-varying electric field. You always remember there exists a direct correlation between electric field and magnetic field when it comes to time-varying fields. We cannot separate electric field and magnetic field for time-varying cases. Suppose a time varying electric field is always associated with magnetic field, and a time varying magnetic field is always associated with electric field, but they are mutually perpendicular to each other. They are traverse in nature. Basically, the electric field and magnetic field cannot exist on the same plane. If electric field in x direction, you can expect magnetic field in y direction. That is called a transverse nature of the field. Suppose in electrostatics, separate relations we had for electric field. In static magnetic fields, we have separate relation for magnetic fields. But when it comes to time varying fields, we cannot separate electric field and magnetic field separately. They have to be related one by the other. That is, magnetic field has to be related with electric field, and electric field has to be related with magnetic field. That we will going to do it in time varying fields. So what do you understand in time varying fields? The time varying electric field is always associated with a magnetic field. A time varying magnetic field is always associated with electric field. This is very well known by Faraday's law. Correct? Now, a change of magnetic flux induces an EMF by Faraday's law. The magnitude of induced EMF in the coil or in a conductor is directly proportional to rate of change of magnetic flux. So the Faraday's law is used to have a link between electric field and the magnetic field. That is EMF. Now we can say EMF is equal to minus d phi by dt by Faraday's law. Correct. Minus we indicates the Lenz law. By Lenz law, the induced EMF always opposes the very cause producing it. What is the cause producing the EMF? The change of magnetic flux. So the change of magnetic flux opposes the induced EMF. So that's why we say that EMF is equal to minus d phi by dt. I'll share you the details. Faraday's law applied to time varying fields. That's what I've explained in the introduction. In the introduction, I just explained how do you relate. We cannot separate electric and magnetic field for time varying cases. So in this chapter, we'll be studying the relation between electric and magnetic fields for time varying fields. So we have started with Faraday's laws for time varying fields. Okay. By the definition. Loss, the EMF is induced due to d phi by dt. We call that as equation number one. We know from electrostatics. Okay, the EMF in a closed path is given by the line integral of E dot dl. We know that. Second chapter of electrostatics. We know that EMF is also, we can write it as is equal to line integral of E dot dl. Okay, now. By the definition of flux density, I'll share the next sheet. By the definition of flux density, we can always define flux as surface integral of B dot ds using equation 2 and equation 3 in equation 1. So EMF can also be written as line integral of E dot dl. And the right hand side, what I have done, I have substituted for what you call it as the phi value. Phi is nothing but from in equation 1, EMF is equal to minus d phi by dt. In place of phi, I have substituted as surface integral of V dot ds. So I have written line integral of V dot dl is equal to minus d by dt of surface integral of V dot ds. I can always interchange the integral and differential. When you take integral, differential in front of integral, it will become a partial differential. giving the line integral of E dot dl is equal to surface minus surface integral of dou b divided by dou t into ds. This is the relation does exist between electric field and the magnetic field for a time varying cases by Faraday's law. We can also further simplify this the relation by using Stokes' theorem in magnetostatics. On the LHS, we are converting line integral into surface integral using Stokes' theorem. What is Stokes' theorem? Line integral of H dot dl is equal to surface integral of del cross H into ds. Correct? No, del cross H. Use that in on the left hand side. So integral surface integral of del cross E into ds is equal to surface minus surface integral of dou b divided by dou t into ds. So both sides surface integral get cancels. So del cross E is equal to minus dou b divided by dou t is the Faraday's law, which is relating the electric field and magnetic field in time varying fields or for time. This is also we call it as point form of Faraday's laws. Okay, del cross E is equal to minus dou b divided by dou t. Have any doubts here? Very simple relation. So del cross E is equal to minus dou b divided by dou t by Faraday's laws. So very important relation you have to remember. They will ask you to explain Faraday's laws for a time varying case. So in order to explain the Faraday's laws for time varying case, you start from the definition of Faraday's law. The EMF induced in the conductor is directly proportional to rate of change of magnetic flux linking the conductor. And the induced EMF always opposes the rate of change of magnetic flux. So by the definition, we can write EMF is equal to minus d phi by dt. Okay. From electrostatics, we know that the EMF in a closed path is given by EMF is equal to line integral of E dot dl. Okay. Call that as equation number 2. We know flux can also be defined as phi is equal to surface integral of B dot ds. Call this as equation number 3. Substitute 2 and 3 in equation 1. So EMF can also be written as line integral of B dot dl. On the right hand side, when you substitute for phi, minus d by dt into surface integral of B dot ds. On the right hand side, we'll interchange the integral and differential. When you interchange integral and differential, the differential will become a partial differential, giving as line integral of E dot dl is equal to minus surface integral of dou b divided by dou t into ds. In order to further simplify the above equation, we use Stokes' theorem. So by Stokes' theorem, line integral of H dot dl is equal to surface integral of del cross H into ds. Okay, use this on the left-hand side of the above equation. So converting E dot dl line integral into surface integral as surface integral of del cross E into ds is equal to surface integral of dou b divided by dou t into ds. Both sides surface integral will get cancels, leaving you with del cross E is equal to minus dou b divided by dou t is the expression for what you call it as or relation between electric field and the magnetic flux density for time varying case. You have any doubts in this? Okay. Now, when you talk about the different types of induced EMF, okay, in a conductor, there can be two types of induced EMFs in a conductor. One is, we call it as generator EMF, other one is called transformer EMF. We know how generator EMF is generated. Do you remember generator EMF and transformer EMF? In a conductor, the total EMF in a conductor can be due to generator EMF and the transformer EMF. The generator EMF, something like two types of EMFs, that is one is statically induced EMF, other one we call it as dynamically induced EMF. Dynamically induced EMF means either magnetic field or conductor should be moving. Statically induced EMF only by merely changing the strength of the current, we can have induced EMF, or maybe changing the path for the charge, we can have what you call it as the EMF. So that type of EMF we call it as transformer EMF. Other one is called the generator EMF. You have a clear idea what is transformer EMF and generator EMF? I'll want to share a you know, derivation for different types of EMFs in a conductor. Yeah. So when you talk about different types of EMFs, as I told you, there can be two different types of EMFs in a conductor. One is called in a generator, a transformer EMF. In a generator EMF, I will, or in a conductor, in order to have induced EMF. In a transformer EMF, you need to, you know, vary the magnitude of current in order to have induced EMF. So total EMF in a conductor is given by the generator EMF plus transformer EMF. So total EMF is equal to EG plus transformer EMF. Now we know already derived the expression for the generator EMF. We know that the EMF is given by minus d phi by dt by Faraday's law. Correct. We know that is EMF is also given by ln integral of E dot dl by electrostatics. When I relate this to, you are going to get line integral of E dot dl is equal to surface integral of dou v divided by dou t into ds. Okay, this is, we call it as a generator EMF. The generator EMF EG is always given by surface integral of dou v divided by dou t into ds, or it can be E dot dl. Okay, now we talk about transformer EMF. In order to have a transformer EMF, you have to change the path of the charge. Means a velocity with which variation of velocity with which the charges move will going to change in order to have an induced EMF. You know that force exerted on moving charge, Fm is equal to Q into V cross B. V is the velocity with which the charge is moving, and B is the flux density in which the charge is moving. So I can write it as Fm, force on moving charge Q is Fm is equal to Q into V cross B. Now we can write it as Em, the moving electric field intensity is given by Em is equal to Fm divided by Q. We know that electric field intensity is 4 per unit charge. When you take charge downwards, Em is equal to Fm divided by Q into V cross B. Okay, so by the definition of EMF, the line integral of EM into DL is equal to the line integral of V cross B into DL. So EMF, the transformer EMF, is always given by line integral of V cross B into DL. So when you substitute this for a transformer EMF, what you are going to get for a total EMF? What is the total EMF now? EMF due to generator EMF and EMF due to transformer EMF. What will be the final expression for EMF? The final expression for EMF will be equal to EG plus ET. EG is surface integral of minus surface integral of dou B divided by dou T. What will be the final expression for ET? The final expression for ET is line integral of V cross B into DL, where V is the velocity with which the charge is moving and B is the flux density in which the charge is moving. So I can write it as the total EMF in a conductor is given by that is minus surface integral of B dot dou B divided by dou T into ds plus line integral of V cross B into DL is the expression. I'll just write that final expression. I may be missing that. Okay. I'll just show you the total EMF. What will be the total EMF in a conductor? The total EMF, ET, E total EMF is equal to EG plus ET. Okay, EG is the generator EMF. How do you get the generator EMF? Minus surface integral of dou b divided by dou t into ds. And what will be the transformer EMF? This transformer EMF will be equal to line integral of v cross b into dl is the expression for total EMF in a conductor. They will ask you from basics, you define different types of EMF in a conductor. In that, you have to define what is a transformer EMF and what is in a generator EMF. Okay. So likewise, you will have other relations also pertaining to the electric field and magnetic field.